Revelation chapter 5, verses 12 and 13 say this: Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. And every created thing which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and all things in them I heard saying, To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and dominion forever and ever. Father, we join our voices with the four living creatures and the elders to worship you this day, proclaiming, Father, that you and the Lamb are worthy of blessing and honor and glory and dominion. You are our God, and we thank you, Father, for the Redeemer, the Lamb of God, who came and gave himself for us. Father, we have gathered here to give you honor and praise and to adore you, but also to hear from you. And so, Father, we pray that you would speak to us this morning through your word, that you would convict us of sin, and that you would serve, Father, to consecrate us and sanctify us, that we would leave this place changed people, and that we would, day by day by day, because of the work of your Spirit through your word, become more and more like your Son. Make us holy, Father, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing hymn 25, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Standing for the reading of God's word, John.
Page This morning's reading is the second book of Chronicles. We're in chapter 1. We'll be reading verses 8 through 13. That's 2 Chronicles, chapter 1, verses 8 through 13, the reading of the holy, inspired, inerrant Word of God. And Solomon said to God, "You have shown great mercy to David, my father, and have made me king in his place. Now, O Lord God, let your promise to David, my father, be established, for you have made me king over a people like the dust of the earth in multitude. Now give me wisdom and knowledge that I may go out and come in before this people, for who can judge this great people of yours?" Then God said to Solomon, "Because this was in your heart, and you have not asked riches or wealth or honor or the life of your enemies, nor have you asked for long life, but have asked wisdom and knowledge for yourself, that you may judge my people over whom I have made you king. Wisdom and knowledge are granted to you, and I will give you riches and wealth and honor such as none of the kings have had who were before you, nor shall any after you have the like." So Solomon came to Jerusalem from the high place that was at Gibeon, from before the tabernacle of meeting, and reigned over Israel. You may be seated. So Solomon now is beginning his reign after his father David, and he had a very significant charge, which was to build God a house on earth, to build the temple. And God appears to him, Almighty God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, creator of heaven and earth, is before Solomon in a dream. And he asks him, "What do you want?" Now, as Solomon answers God in prayer, before he even asks for his wish, we can kind of get some insight in the heart of Solomon and understand a few things about how we approach God in prayer. "You have shown great mercy to David, my father, and have made me king in his place." What does that tell us? We see God as the source. We see God as the one who gives. God is the one who bestowed honor on David. Not that David was a great warrior or a leader in and of himself, but rather this was given to him from God. And Solomon recognizes this. And now, understanding what God's purpose is for his life, namely that he would rule over Israel and build this temple, he asks God, "Let your promise to David, my father, be established, for you have made me king over a people like the dust of the earth in multitude." You have made me king. Another acknowledgement that whatever he has is from God. So that's what we call humility, where we recognize that everything we have, any place we have in life, comes from our Almighty God in heaven. And when we approach God with that kind of attitude in our heart, which in itself is a gift, we are on the right track. Now he asks him for wisdom that I may judge this great people that you've given me. And he doesn't ask for, he doesn't ask for things for himself, but rather he asks that he might fulfill that which God has given him to do. So we have a man whose desires and his will and what he wishes are in tune and in alignment with what God wants from him. So what he asks for is not temporal, it's not for the here and now, it's not that he may glorify himself, but rather that he might glorify God. There's a passage in James that says, "You ask and you receive not, because you ask that you might consume it upon your own lusts." Right? That's a very earthly, temporal way to ask for things in prayer. But rather, when our desires are in tune with God's desires, we ask for his glory and we receive. That's the primacy that we need to have when we go to our Heavenly Father. Not to say we can't go to him for things that are on our heart, right? If any of us are anxious, right? Let us go to God in Philippians 4, we read that. But we see in Solomon a real desire to carry out the will of God. And we see the blessing of God that not only does God give Solomon wisdom, but then he gives him the earthly to go along with it. And it's because Solomon's heart was right with God by his grace, but also it shows the abundant mercy and blessing of the God that we serve. And, to close, I would say If God came to you and asked you, what would you want? How do we answer that? Right? And I'm not playing gotcha with anybody. We let the Holy Spirit do its work. But there's a psalm in Psalm 37, verse 4. It says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Now, we can look at that a couple of ways. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give us the desires of our heart. Namely, whatever I ask for God, I'll get. The other way to look at that is delight yourself in the Lord, and the desire, he will give you your desire. That is, the desires that we have will be from God, so that when we pray, we will be asking for the things that God wants us to ask for. Do we see that? Delight ourselves in the Lord, brothers and sisters. Let him be our delight. Right? Amen? Let him be our delight. And then the desires of our heart are in tune with God. And we too, like Solomon, when we pray, will receive the abundant blessings from God, not only in this life, but in the world to come. Amen.
Our Father and our God, our problem is not that we desire too much. Our problem is that we do not desire enough. We are content with small things when we ought to desire the greatest of all, more of you, more of Christ. Forgive us, Father, for having desires that are so earthbound and base. Lift our eyes, Father, above the horizon that we might see what you have for us, that we might understand your word when we open it, that we might see the glory that is contained within it, that we might see your Son, Jesus Christ, who has come to show us who you are. Father, these are the things for which we were created. These are the ways in which you desire to bless us. Father, you desire to give us the very best that exists in this universe, which is more of yourself. Do so, Father. Again, Father, we ask that you would forgive us for not desiring you more. Put that desire within us. May your Spirit work within us, Father, so that we might love you and hunger for you and thirst for you. And may we say, Father, with the psalmist, blessed be the Lord who daily bears our burden, the God who is our salvation. God is to us a God of deliverances, and to God the Lord belongs escape from death. You are our God. You are our salvation. You are our deliverer. May we be content with nothing less. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Let's turn in our Bibles once again to Psalm 75. Psalm 75, this too, a song of Asaph that we have in the Word, who was a choir director for the people of God. Psalm 75. We give thanks to you, O God, we give thanks. Your name is near. Men declare your wondrous works. When I select an appointed time, it is I who judge with equity. The earth and all who dwell in it melt. It is I who have firmly set its pillars. I said to the boastful, do not boast, and to the wicked, do not lift up the horn. Do not lift up your horn on high. Do not speak with insolent pride. For not from the east, nor from the west, nor from the desert comes exaltation. But God is the judge. He puts down one and exalts another. For a cup is in the hand of the Lord, and the wine foams. It is well mixed, and he pours out of this. Surely all the wicked of the earth must drain and drink down its dregs. But as for me, I will declare it forever. I will sing praises to the God of Jacob, and all the horns of the wicked he will cut off, but the horns of the righteous will be lifted up. Our gracious God and Father, you are indeed the God who speaks through your word. And you are the sovereign God who judges, who declares righteous, who tears down the wicked, and raises up those whom you choose. You are this kind of a God. You are this God for your people. You are this God in the world. We will declare it forever. We will sing praises to the God of Jacob. For you, Father, the God of Jacob, are our God. We who trust in Christ by faith are the children of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. We are yours. And we look to that day, Father, when the wicked will be cut off. When in your judgment, Father, you will vindicate your people and you will declare what is right and what is good. And you will reveal, Father, the redeemed for who they are. And this creation will rejoice as it too is transformed into the new heavens and the new earth, as Paul describes there in Romans chapter 8. We thank you, Father, that you are the kind of a God who is described here in this psalm. You are not a God who takes your own character and your own holiness lightly, who allows sin to go unpunished. Rather, Father, you are a God who judges sin and mercifully justifies sinners. Indeed, Father, because you hold your own holiness to be of such import, you sent your own Son to be a substitute for sinners, that the wrath that is due upon us came upon him. Father, how grateful we are. Help us to understand all that that means, that we might give you thanks. We thank you, Father, that having justified a people to your own possession, you have called us to gather together in local congregations, such as the church that you have raised up here. And we thank you for that, Father, that we are not yours in isolation, but we are yours in communion with others whom you have redeemed as well. And you have called us, Father, to love one another and to serve one another. You have called us, Father, to encourage and to confront one another. You have called us to come alongside, Father, and help one another through this life that we live in this sin-sick world. With all of the challenges, Father, and all of the confrontations, with all of the temptations that we face, you have not left us alone. Your Spirit indwells us, and your Son intercedes for us, and you have given us a family. We thank you for that, that together we can come together and worship you in this place. Together we can come and intercede for one another. Together we can serve. We're grateful for that. Thank you, Father, for your church. Thank you for your people. Thank you for those that you are raising up to go forth out of their own homes and their own congregations to proclaim the gospel in other parts of the world. We thank you for what we are seeing, Father, around the world as others who are hearing about Christ are coming to faith in him. We thank you, Father, for the great work that you are doing in Asia and in South America and in Africa and even in Islamic countries, Father, as we rejoice at the reports we hear of those who are hearing the gospel and coming to faith in Jesus Christ. We pray that you would continue to do that great work. And even as we rejoice in all of this, Father, we are concerned with our own nation. For we see the church, Father, falling away in so many different ways. We pray, Father, you would restore us. We pray that you would bring revival to this place, to our own homes. We ask, Father, that you would revive the church in the West that is so rapidly dying and turning away from faithfulness to your word. Do this, Father, bring us back to a devotion to the Word of God, and to a confidence in its power. We pray, Father, that we would not take confidence in the political realm, but rather in the power of your Spirit to accomplish your will. At the same time, Father, we recognize that you have commanded us to pray for our leaders, and so we do. We pray for our president, Father. We ask that you would change his heart and mind and bring him more fully into line with the Word of God, that he might recognize the truth that is contained in the Scriptures. We pray that this would affect the policy making in our nation, that the laws of this nation might more fully reflect the truth of your word. We pray this, Father, for Congress and for our governor as well, for all those that you have raised up and put into positions of authority. We pray that those who make the laws of our land might make such laws which more accurately reflect your character. We pray, Father, that as we pray for our leaders, that we might be left to live quiet and peaceable lives, serving you without interference. We pray this even as we pray for the persecuted church, because we know, Father, that the normal course of this world is to oppose your people and to oppose your church. And there are those who are suffering for the sake of the gospel even as we speak. Strengthen them and encourage them, Father. Give them joy even in the midst of their suffering. And prepare us for that day that will eventually come when we endure that suffering as well. May we stand firm when the time comes. Thank you, Father, for your Son. We rejoice in the redemption which is ours through him, and we give him honor and glory and praise. Lift him up among us this day. May we see him as we come to your word. May we see him, Father, reflected on the pages of Scripture, and may we be moved to worship and to rejoice as a result. For Christ's sake we ask it. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing. Have thine own way, Lord. May this be our prayer this morning.
ushers please come forward? Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have done for us. We taste and see your goodness, and all that we have is yours. And we thank you, Father, for all that you have entrusted to us. We pray, Lord, that as we return some of what you have given, not for your favor, not because you need it, but because you invite us to demonstrate our love for you, to participate with you as you accomplish your work in and through Red Mills and around the world. We ask that you would bless these gifts, Lord, which come from you and through your people. Use them for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's take our Bibles once more and turn to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. I neglected to mention this morning in our announcements, there will be a membership class taking place, and we've scheduled that for Thursday evening, April 3rd, and Sunday afternoon, April 6th. So if you have not yet spoken to me about that, and that's a desire that you have, please let me know. We're going to be looking at the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 35 through 51 this morning. We began this passage last week and want to continue that this morning, as we did not finish examining this entire passage. But I want to read the whole thing again from verse 35 through 51. Again the next day, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. And Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, "What do you seek?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come, and you will see." So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the tenth hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He found first his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which translated means Christ. He brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The next day he purposed to go into Galilee, and he found Philip, and Jesus said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, of the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him and said to him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you that I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Father, once again, we come to you in complete dependence. Left to ourselves, Father, we are blind. But by your Spirit, you have caused us to see. Those of us who have trusted in Christ have done so because you have opened our eyes and enabled us to see him for who he really is. Father, we desire this morning to see with greater clarity. Show us your Son in his glory this morning as we open your word together. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. Well, as we said last week, as we came to examine this text, when we come to the text of Scripture, even though there are lots of different people mentioned and described within it, they all serve in order to point us to and teach us concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the focal point of all of Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament, and of every passage in the Word of God. Christ is there. And here, in this passage particularly, John wants us to understand all kinds of different things about who Jesus is. So last week, as we began to open up this passage, we saw a number of things about who Jesus is and what he has done. The first thing, for instance, that we saw, that Jesus is the atoning sacrifice. We see this in verse 36 when John the Baptist points to him and says, "Here is the Lamb of God." Because of our sin, a sacrifice is needed, a substitutionary sacrifice. We need one to come and suffer in our place. We need one to come and die in our place. Someone who will take upon himself the wrath of God that we deserve. We need a sacrifice who would come and fulfill the law of God in all of its perfection. We need a pure and a holy sacrifice, and that's who Jesus was, and that's what Jesus did. He is the Lamb of God. Jesus, secondly, is to be followed. It's not enough to simply know about Jesus. He must be followed. That's what we saw in verse 37. The two disciples that heard John the Baptist declare that this one was the Lamb of God followed Jesus. And we said it is not enough to simply be attracted to Jesus. It's not enough to know certain facts about him. It's not enough to enjoy the things that Jesus can do for you. Jesus calls not only to receive from his hand, but to follow him in obedience as well. These disciples understood that. These disciples understood that to really follow Jesus is to really know Jesus, is to not know things about him. To know Jesus is not to use him for one's own purposes. To know Jesus in the true sense is to follow him, to be obedient to him, to understand that he is Lord, and to give our lives over to his lordship. The third thing we saw in verse 37 and verse 39 is that when they came and followed him and asked him, "Where are you staying?" in response to the question of Jesus to them, "What do you seek?" Jesus then responded and says, "Come and you will see." And we said that there's something more going on than Jesus answering a question as to where he was staying. We likened this to what we see so often in the Gospels, as Jesus speaks in the same earthly language as those he's speaking to, but he has a higher meaning. When he speaks to Nicodemus, for instance, and he speaks of being born again, he means much more than Nicodemus understood by it. Nicodemus was thinking on an earthly level of physical birth. Jesus was thinking of the spiritual rebirth and regeneration. Likewise here, Jesus has come into a world of blind people, and it is Jesus who enables blind people to see. Jesus, we said, is the giver of spiritual sight. When John Newton wrote Amazing Grace and wrote in that first stanza, "I once was blind, but now I see," he was not saying that he was blind and somehow gave himself the ability to see. He's saying that Jesus gave him the ability to understand spiritual things. His spiritual blindness was taken from him, and he received sight so as to understand the gospel and to see Jesus for who he really is. That's the third thing that we saw last week. Jesus is the giver of spiritual sight. We also saw, fourthly, that Jesus is the Christ. In verses 40 and 41, we read that one of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. And he found first his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which translated means Christ. Now this is how they saw when Jesus gave them spiritual sight. What did they see? They saw, they understood that this Jesus is the Messiah that they had been waiting for. Here is the one that God's people had waited for century after century after century as they sought to see the messianic fulfillment. And then here we have these very average men coming and finally saying, "We have found him. We have found the Messiah. We have found the one of whom the Scripture speaks. We have found the salvation of God." We saw too last week that Jesus changes lives. This is the fifth thing that we saw. And we saw this in verse 42 as Jesus speaks to Simon now and says, "You're Simon, you're the son of John, but from now on, your name is Peter." And Jesus just takes upon himself the authority to change his name. It's a very amazing thing. Peter comes to meet Jesus, and the first thing Jesus says is not, "Hi, how are you doing? Nice to meet you." First thing Jesus says is, "I'm changing your name." Right? It's a weird thing if you're on Peter's side, unless you've been given this spiritual sight to understand this one has that authority. And indeed he did. And he has the authority to change our lives just as he had the authority to change Peter's name. He takes those who are dead in sin and he makes them live. He takes those who are in bondage and he sets them free. He comes to us and he gives us that spiritual sight and he makes us new creatures in him. We saw sixthly that Jesus is him who calls as well. In verse 43, we read, "The next day he purposed to go into Galilee, and he found Philip, and Jesus said to him, 'Follow me.'" A little strange there as well, isn't it? If you're Philip, you have this man just comes up to you, "Follow me." And Philip does. Jesus now takes the initiative. Later on, he's going to make explicit what's happening here when he says to his disciples, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." If you're a disciple of Christ, it's not because you chose him. You chose Christ only because he first chose you and called you. And you find that language, as we said last week, throughout the Scripture. The people of God and churches of God are called to him. God does the calling. And we're constantly referred to through Scripture as those who are called. Finally, last week, the seventh thing we saw was that Jesus knows us completely. That's pretty clear as we read through this account, particularly in verses 47 and 48, when Jesus sees Nathanael coming to him and knows before Nathanael even approaches him what kind of man Nathanael is. This is a man in whom there is no deceit. Jesus says, "I saw you, Philip." Even before Philip called you, Nathanael, "I saw you. I saw you when you were under the fig tree." He knows our circumstances and he knows who we are as people. Jesus knows us inside and out. He knows all of our sin and all of our secrets, and he went to the cross anyway. And that is grace. That is grace. Now let's pick up here where we left off last week. Jesus can and will do all that we have spoken of because of what comes next in this passage. Because he is the Son of God. Verse 49, Nathanael answers him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." You can understand Nathanael getting this. He's just been told things about himself that Jesus had no natural way of knowing. Clearly, there's something different about this man. There is something unique. And Nathanael doesn't say, clearly, you're psychic. Right? Clearly, you've got some kind of sixth sense. No, Nathanael understands because his eyes have been open already. This is the Son of God. Now, what does it mean that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the eighth thing, by the way, if you're keeping track, as we're coming through this text of 10 things that John is revealing to us about Jesus in this passage. Jesus is the Son of God. What does that mean? Well, it means a couple of things. First, it means that Jesus is God. The term Son of God, that title, that description, speaks of the deity of Christ. Paul says in Colossians 2:9, "In him the whole fullness of deity dwells bodily." He says in Philippians 2:6, "Though he was in the form of God, he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but he emptied himself." Why didn't he consider equality with God a thing to be grasped? Because he already had it. He didn't need to grasp it. He is in the form of God bodily, the incarnation of God. God taken on human flesh. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 and 3 says, "In these last days God has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of God's glory, the very stamp of his nature, upholding the universe by his word and power." All that God is, you see in Christ, because Christ himself is God incarnate. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 8 and 9 says, "Of the Son," he says, "your throne, O God, is forever and ever." Isn't that a strange statement? He's bringing us back to David's statement in the Psalms, where David is speaking of the Son and referring to him as Yahweh. "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever." And John, of course, has already written, as we've seen earlier in John chapter 1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth." You see, when Jesus is called the Son of God, we understand that title to mean Jesus is God. He is not a mere man. He is not a high-ranking angel in human form. He is truly man and truly God. When we call him the Son of God, we mean that he is of the same nature as God. Fathers create things unlike themselves, but they beget sons who are like themselves. C.S. Lewis put it like this: "When you beget something of the same kind as yourself. A man begets human babies, a beaver begets little beavers, and a bird begets eggs which turn into little birds. But when you make or create, you make something of a different kind from yourself. A bird makes a nest, a beaver builds a dam, a man makes a wireless set." Now, this was back in the 40s, right? So, "a man makes a computer," right? We might say today. Right? You make something which is a different nature from your own, but you beget that which is of your own nature. So when we say that Jesus is the Son of God, we mean that God has begotten his Son in his very same divine nature, nothing else, and this from all eternity. So don't listen to this language of begetting and think creating. That's not what we're talking about. Don't listen to the language of begetting and think beginning. There is no beginning here. We're talking about something that is true from all eternity. Begetting is simply a metaphor. It is God using language to seek to communicate something to us that is hugely difficult for us to understand. Don't take things too literally. God's trying to communicate truth here to us that is really well beyond our comprehension, which shouldn't cause us a problem. It should be a comfort to us. It should be understandable to us, because God is so far above us, we ought not to think we can understand everything about him. And so when we come across difficult things, that should just be natural. That should be expected. I'm not God. I'm finite. I'm a finite person with a finite mind trying to understand the infinite. Of course I'm going to struggle. Of course I'm going to have difficulty with some of these things. And yet what we find in this great doctrine of the Trinity and of the deity of Christ as the Son of God is nothing that is contradictory or irrational. It might be supra-rational, above simple rational thought, but it is not contradictory or irrational. It makes perfect sense when you keep things in their categories. Why do people have difficulty with the doctrine of the Trinity? It's because they mix up their categories. They hear about three and one, and they say, well, something can't be both three and one at the same time. Well, what are we talking about? When we talk about God being both three and one, we need to remember we're not talking about this God being three and one in the same respect. We're talking about God being three in person. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. But we're speaking about God being one in his essence. What is it that makes God God? And so there's no contradiction there because we're not speaking of God being three persons and one person. That's not what we're saying. Neither are we talking about God being three in essence and one in essence. That's not what we're saying. Three in person and one in essence. We're talking about different aspects of who God is when we talk about God being three and one. When we talk about God being, about Christ being the Son of God, we're holding two truths together. God the Father is not the Son, and God the Son is not God the Father. They are distinct persons, distinct centers of consciousness, so to speak, and they can relate to one another. The Trinity came together in council in eternity past to determine to accomplish redemption. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But just as God the Father is not God the Son, and God the Son is not God the Father and the Son are not two gods. They are one God, one divine nature, one essence. From all eternity, without any beginning, the Father has always had a perfect image of himself and a divine reflection of his radiance, equal to himself, namely the Son. And so the first thing that we mean when we say Jesus is the Son of God is that Jesus is God. The second thing we mean by this is that God has a unique love for Jesus, his Son. God has a unique love for Jesus, the Son of God. In Colossians, Paul describes Jesus as the Son of God's love, implying that the love for his divine Son is utterly unique from the love that God has for all of his human creation by adoption. See, we are sons of God too if we are in Christ. We are sons and daughters of the Most High, but not in the same way that Jesus is. We are sons and daughters by adoption. Jesus is a son by begetting. Completely different scenario. God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of the Son of his love, or his beloved Son. That's what the scripture tells us. So because of what Christ, the beloved Son of God, has done, we are able to become the children of God by adoption. We were not always the children of God, but we become the children of God through what Christ has done, the one who has always been the Son of God. Twice in the earthly life of Jesus, once at his baptism and once on the Mount of Transfiguration, God the Father breaks into history, breaks into this world and says, "This is my beloved Son." In Ephesians 1:6, Jesus is simply called God's beloved. There is this unique relationship between them. It is the reason why John can say in his epistles, God is love. Have you ever considered that? How can God be love? if in eternity past he had no creation upon which to demonstrate his love? How does love is something that must be extended out from oneself. Love is something that must be demonstrated. How can God be love in his very nature if there was nothing to love? But there was something to love. There was someone to love. God loved within the fellowship of the Trinity in eternity past. God the Father loved the Son, and the Son loved the Father and the Spirit, and all the combinations of Father, Son, and Spirit. Love was interacting between the three persons of the Godhead before anything else was ever created. That's how God can be love in his very nature, because it's extended even to himself. So when we call Jesus the Son of God, we should have in our minds the truth that he is God, and that there is a relationship of infinite and eternal love between God the Father and God the Son that is different from all other loves. Just consider some of these truths let's set forth for us in the Scriptures about the Son of God. 1 John 5:12 says, God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who has not the Son of God has not life. This Son, who has life in himself, is the way by which we obtain life. It comes through him. 1 John 2:23 says, no one who denies the Son has the Father. He who confesses the Son has the Father also. So in order to have a relationship with God the Father, and to have eternal life, one has to confess Jesus as God the Son and have Jesus as the Son of God, that is, be in fellowship with him. Galatians 4, verses 4 and 5 gives the foundation of all this hope. When the time had fully come, God sent forth his Son to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. So God the Father sent his one and only divine Son so that through that eternal Son, we might become sons and daughters by adoption. We were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, Paul says in Romans 5. Galatians 2:20, Paul says that we live by faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. So Jesus is the Son of God. But another wonderful thing that John wants us to know about him is that he has a specific place within the historical outworking of God's plan of redemption. And so the ninth thing that John wants to teach us about Jesus in this passage is that he is also the King of Israel. Yes, he's the Son of God, and he is eternally the second person of the Godhead, but he is also in history the King of Israel. Look at verse 49 once again. This is part of Nathanael's response to Jesus telling him all about himself. And he says, Rabbi, you are the Son of God, and he understands as well he is the King of Israel. Son of God and King of Israel were linked in the Old Testament as twin titles for the Messiah. And so all of these connections are being made by these first disciples. He is the Messiah, which translated means Christ. He is the Son of God. He is the King of Israel. And they're seeing all of these things wrapped up in this one person of Jesus Christ. You can see it in Psalm 2, verses 2 to 7. The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. That's another word for the Messiah. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Right there in Psalm 2, you see the same personage spoken of as the Messiah, as the Son of God, and as the King of Israel. And the disciples are getting it. How are they getting it? They're getting it because God is opening their eyes. He's giving them spiritual sight, and they're understanding these things. So here we have the Messiah, the King, and the Son, all referred to in the same person in Psalm 2, and that's the background for Nathanael's outburst in verse 49. You are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. He means you're the expected one. You're the one spoken of all the way back in 2 Samuel and in Psalm 2. You are the Messiah. The time for the fulfillment of your messianic promise is here. The kingdom of God is about to be established here on the earth, and the enemies of God's people are going to be defeated. The Messiah will take the nations for his inheritance and rule the nations as a king with a rod of iron, just like Psalm 2 says. But even though Nathanael was right about Jesus being the Messiah, at the same time, Nathanael believed both too much and too little about Jesus' sonship and his kingship. Too much because this son and king would be executed as a criminal rather than a conqueror of Rome. That's what Nathanael would have expected. That's what so many of the Jews in the first century expected. When the Messiah comes, he's coming as a warrior, he's coming as a political leader, and he is going to throw out Rome, and he's going to sit on David's throne here in Jerusalem. And that's not what Jesus did. He also believed too little because these terms son and king meant so much more than he could have possibly realized. Consider the title Son of God and what it came to mean in Jesus' ministry. In John 5:18, we read, "This was why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God." Something was happening in Jesus' ministry that the Jewish leaders could not tolerate. Jesus was teaching that his sonship meant his deity, as we have seen. The Pharisees knew that. They understood the implications of all that Jesus was saying, and they considered it blasphemous. It would have been blasphemous if it was not true. Of course, it was true. But in addition to being the Son of God, Jesus was also the divinely ordained Son of David as well. He was the fulfillment of the promise that a son of David would sit on the Davidic throne forever. This was God's promise in 2 Samuel 7. There would come a descendant of David whose reign would never end. Now, when Jesus was born, the angel said to Mary in Luke chapter 1, verses 32 and 33, "The Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." In other words, 2 Samuel 7:13 would be fulfilled in this child, Jesus. The title King of Israel, just like the title Son of God, was more and it was less than most of Jesus' followers saw at first. Less because he would not become an earthly king and destroy the Roman overlords as they were hoping for and expecting. But it was more because this kingship too, just like the sonship, was a divine kingship. In the end, the Jewish leaders would use the charge of treason to get Jesus crucified by the Roman governor Pilate. In John chapter 19, verse 12, we read, "Pilate sought to release him. But the Jews cried out, 'If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar.'" Jesus was the Son of God, and Jesus was the King of Israel. And both of those statements are magnificent descriptions of who this person is. One who demands allegiance. One who demands obedience. But there's a third title for us to note. As we come to the end of this passage this morning, the tenth thing that John wants us to know about Jesus is revealed in the title found in verse 51. Right at the end of the verse, "The Son of Man." It's probably not what you think it is. In John chapter 1, verses 50 and 51, we read this, that Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you that I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Strange passage, isn't it? Most of us, when we hear the term Son of Man, our minds immediately go to the humanity of Christ. And we want to contrast this phrase with the Son of God and say, well, Jesus was fully God and he was fully man. But there's so much more to it than that. In this strange passage here at the end of chapter 1, Jesus is calling to mind another picture from another portion of Scripture. You'll remember back in Genesis chapter 28, Jacob has a dream. And on this dream, he sees angels going up and down on a ladder. And we're told that he dreamed, and behold, there was a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, "I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and to your offspring. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it." Now what helps us to understand the significance of the angels going up and down here in John 1:51 is that neither in John chapter 1 nor in Genesis 28 is a single word spoken to explain what the angels were doing. What do you mean going up and down on a ladder or here on the Son of Man? What does that mean? What were they doing? And we're never told. We're never given an explanation. It seems, therefore, that what John has done is simply to capture the whole incident from Genesis to say two things. And they're things not about the angels, but about Jesus. One is that Jesus is the decisive final connection between heaven and earth. In John 1:51, the angels are going up and down, but they're not going up and down on a ladder. Did you catch this? The angels of God are ascending and descending on the Son of Man. I don't even know what that looks like. You try to picture that. I don't know. But what it means, at least, is that Jesus is the focal point of those who ascend and who descend. The other thing is to say that Jesus is the place where the people now meet God. Jacob called that place Beth-El, the house of God, because he said, "Surely God is in this place." And now Jesus is the new Bethel. Jesus is the place where God is present. Heaven has opened and Jesus has appeared. And from now on, Jesus will be the place where God appears among men and where men find their way into fellowship with God. There are no holy geographic places any longer designating a place where God dwells. God dwells in Christ, and that's where we meet him. In his Son, in the Son of Man. Jesus is that meeting place. That's the picture, I think, that John is trying to give to us when he records Jesus' words, connecting what's going on here with Genesis 28. Jesus was saying to Nathanael, "If you follow me, you're going to see far greater manifestations of the divine glory than what you just saw. You think it's a big thing that I could tell you about yourself, having never met you? You're going to see much more amazing things than that. I am the final decisive link with heaven, both upward and downward. When we move heavenward, we move on the Son of Man. When God comes down to us, God comes on the Son of Man." But why this title? Why the Son of Man in verse 51? It's not simply because he was a man. The title comes from the prophet Daniel, back in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 13. And in Daniel 7:13, the Son of Man is both human and far more than human. So this was Jesus' favorite designation of himself. Jesus was always referring to himself as the Son of Man. It's used over 80 times in the Gospels. And only Jesus uses it to refer to himself. He got the title Son of Man, as we said, from Daniel chapter 7. Verses 13 and 14 say this, "I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven there came one like a Son of Man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed." So the language used there to describe the Son of Man is language of kingship and sovereignty and dominion and glory. But it has a different ring than the term Son of God and King of Israel. It sounds, when you first hear it, more ordinary, more lowly, perhaps. So when Jesus used it, his claims to kingship and glory and sovereignty didn't immediately sound so overt. Only those who had ears to hear understood the exalted meaning of the term as Jesus was using it. So this time it was not the Jewish leaders who used the title to bring him to the cross. Jesus himself uses it that way. The key verse is John chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." You see, when Jesus is described as the Son of Man, or when he describes himself as the Son of Man, he is not being described as something less than his other titles reveal him to be. The Son of Man is, in fact, taking all that his other titles imply and bringing them together in this one title, the Son of Man. He's saying something of himself that is inclusive of all those other titles. And he's pointing us once again to the redemptive purpose for which he comes. That's what's going on there in John chapter 3. Just like Moses lifted up that serpent in the wilderness so all of the people of Israel who were bitten by the snakes could look upon that, and in looking in faith, they would be healed, they would be saved. So as Jesus is lifted up, all who look upon him in faith will be saved. He is that kind of a savior. Jesus indeed was lifted up on the cross. And in being lifted up, he fulfilled all that Moses said about him in the five books of Moses. And he fulfilled all that was said about him in the historical books of the Old Testament. And he fulfilled all that was said about him in the Psalms and the other poetic books of the Old Testament. And he fulfilled all that was said about him in the prophetic books of the Old Testament. Because he is the Son of God and the King of Israel and the Son of Man. And depending upon which aspect we're speaking of, he has either been these things from eternity, or it was the eternal decree of God that he should fulfill these roles. And we've got to understand that everything we've seen about Jesus in these past 2 weeks, from beginning to end, is in some way connected to the cross. It's connected with his redemptive work, connected with him being lifted up. That's why he came. That's what was determined in the council of the Godhead before creation in eternity past. And like these first disciples who at this point understood so little and yet followed, we are called upon to follow even though there is much that we don't yet understand. Like the thief on the cross, who pleaded with Christ to remember him when he came into his kingdom, there was much that he didn't understand. We stand amazed that Jesus could speak to this one and say, "Today you'll be with me in paradise," even though he had never been discipled. He had never sat through a sermon proclaiming Jesus as the Redeemer and Lord and Son of God and Son of Man. He knew virtually nothing except that God has opened his heart to understand, this one is where my salvation lies. This is the one I must come to and depend on. This is the one who can save me from the wrath of God. We may understand little more than that, but if we understand that much, we understand it because God has opened our eyes to see Jesus as the Son of God, as the King of Israel, and the Son of Man. May God grant us the grace to follow then wherever he may lead. Father, thank you. Thank you for this glorious picture of Jesus, the Redeemer, divine Redeemer, God in every aspect, and yet one who came and took on flesh in order to redeem. And even now, Father, we know that Jesus Christ is King. He is Lord of glory. He sits at your right hand. And we wait, Father. We wait for that day when the King will come once again, bursting through the clouds. Father, what a glorious day it will be. Until that day, continue to build your church. Continue to build your kingdom. And draw, Father, draw men and women and boys and girls. Open their eyes, open their minds, open their ears, open their hearts, Father, that they might understand the truth, that they might see Jesus for who he is and follow. And Father, make us faithful followers. May that be the focus of our lives. May that be our identity in all things, that we are adopted children of God and followers of the Savior. These things we ask in his name. Amen.
In Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.